Today we're talking about Mexico's drug policies, which, as a surprise to some, don't read like the lyrics to a mid-2000s rap song. While most people think that the war on drugs is a US war fought on the battlefield of your least favorite episodes of TV shows, and if you're not white, police arresting people for possession of illegal substances. Well, in Mexico, it's a bit more of a literal war on drugs. In recent years, more than 130,000 Mexican military personnel have been involved in drug war-related activities on an annual basis. And to put that number into perspective, according to the Congressional Research Office, we had only about 20% more troops than that in active duty in Iraq at the height of Operation Enduring Freedom. And boy, did that freedom endure. So why are we talking about this today? I mean, it's not really breaking news that there's a violence and drug problem in Mexico. I mean, if it wasn't a problem, Trump might literally be speechless. Instead, we're talking about the new Mexican president and his wildly different solutions to this problem.
It's been 12 years since the Mexican military entered the country's deadly war on drugs. Despite the intervention, there have been more than 200,000 drug-related murders since 2006. And Mexico's new president says it's time for a new strategy.
So what's the new strategy? Well, he campaigned with slogans like hugs, not gunshots? Come on, you gotta make it hugs, not drugs. The rhyme is right there. It's at this point it should be clear that, if the incoming president gets his way, there will be Mexico's first major split from the US on crime fighting and drugs in decades. Because the closest you'll get to a hug from one of our officers is...
It's cold outside.
Yeah, it's cold?
Yeah, that's a deadie.
Okay, what's this right here?
That's my penis.
That's your penis, alright.
Apparently it's not too cold outside. So what's Obrador's plan? It has three parts. First, take the military off the streets and replace them with better trained, better paid, more professional police. Yeah, but every politician promises to pull their troops out of unstable countries during their campaign. So first, why Mexican soldiers instead of police in the first place? I mean, is this a literal war on drugs? Not really. By the government's own analysis, Mexico has fewer than half the police officers it needs. And that is based on need, so this is less about fighting crime and more about averting the purge. Even worse, of the half of the necessary police force they do have, only 42% meet basic competency standards. Oh god, we're entering into Trump cabinet levels of incompetency. So what happens when the crime gets out of hand? Well, according to Mexico's new head of the Department of Public Security, Alfonso Duranzo Montaño, wow, that's quite a name. The presence of the army created a perverse incentive. It creates indifference of police chiefs and governors because they know that if they fail, they can call the army and keep delaying the improvement of police forces. It's never a good sign when there's an accepted and well-trodden protocol for exactly what to do when your local government gets overrun. Honey, it appears as though the government has lost control of our city again. Well, I guess it's time to send in the military. It's so bad Mexico is catching heat from the Philippines, a country not exactly known for having a stellar record on drug wars or public safety.
Would you enjoy going to Mexico with all the kidnappings and killing there? Drugs. Colombia. Everywhere. America.
As you can imagine, there are few problems with trying to double the size of a police department while at the same time trying to boost half of your officers to performing at basic competency. Yeah, oh man, that sounds bad. Wrong number. This is 912. One of the biggest logistical hurdles is that this is not a federal problem, because just like in America, police are managed at federal, state, and municipal levels. So you will have to convince the leader of some municipalities in the rural parts of Mexico that having a well-funded police force is better than paying part of the salary of soldiers deployed in their jurisdiction with funds that get sucked out of their own police forces. It hasn't always been this way, though.
Former Mexican President Felipe Calderón was the first to send large numbers of troops to fight drug traffickers back in late 2006. Since then, more than 200,000 people have been killed in the nation's drug war, and more than 30,000 have gone missing.
Okay, yeah, that actually sounds like something even diehard states' rights advocates would say. Yeah. yeah, we should probably leave this one up to the federal government. Especially because remember that incompetency complaint? Well, it's really hard for local police to fight a drug war when 1,900 of Garo's 4,500 municipal police failed the control and trust evaluations. Those who fail the test are not supposed to carry guns. That's right, in...
Despite the presence of security forces, Mexico's southern state of Guerrero continues to be a main producer of heroin. Residents and experts say drug-related violence and dire poverty are part of daily life there.
42% of police officers are required to bring a knife to the gunfight. The solution proposed by the head of Department of Public Security is, we'll ensure police can live in a dignified middle-class life with medical care, retirement, and a good salary. Well, why didn't anyone else think of that? Police are actually paid, on average, about $500 a month in Mexico, though. So the thinking here is, you can improve conditions and gradually grow a larger and more talented police force capable of handling some of these problems without declaring martial law. The next plank of Obrador's plan is to rewrite drug laws to potentially legalize marijuana and poppy production. Okay, well, clearly some commenters are gonna love this topic. Former Supreme Court Justice and likely next Interior Minister Olga Sanchez Cordero isn't exactly subtle about her beliefs, recently saying on a radio show, Canada's legalized it, half of the United States has legalized it. What are we thinking, killing ourselves when the rest of North America and much of Europe has legalized it? Whoa, 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 let's not get peer pressured into drugs here. With the previous administration, we saw...
The current president of Mexico does not intend to legalize marijuana, even though the Supreme Court in the country ruled in favor of legalization.
But with this new administration, it looks like this sticky issue might conclude with legal marijuana. The more difficult issue is legalizing the growth of poppies, which are used to make opioids. Alright, don't get me wrong, this isn't a, oh man, well, weed's legal, what's the next narcotic you can think of situation. Instead, Mexico has a thriving poppy trade, but because of international regulations, they have to import all their medical opioids and deal with the even more criminal organizations of Big Pharma. What some are proposing is that Mexico go to the International Narcotics Control Board so they can start getting high on their own supply. Strictly for medical purposes, though. The idea would be that instead of fighting with the farmers, you partner with them for the greater good. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you thought that plank was controversial, brace yourself, because this final one, well, it's a doozy.
Poor farmers growing opium poppies in Mexico's violent southwest, and hawks, young lookouts in the territories the country's gangs are battling over. Two examples of those who could benefit from President-elect Andrés Manuel López Obrador's most controversial proposal. Amnesty for those on the lowest rungs of organized crime.
Oh man, warned ya. The new head of the Department of Public Security has gone on record saying an amnesty plan would likely be offered to people who produced or planted drugs for cartels, or served as drug mules or lookouts. Now, the government won't just hand these out like condoms in a dorm. Here's a bowl, just take as many amnesties as you need. Oh, you're back for seconds, here you go. Instead, they would exchange amnesties for information to build cases against higher-ups. Still though, this is incredibly controversial, especially coupled with a program to reduce sentences or releasing convicts serving time for non-violent drug offenses. This was defended under the super presumptuous statements of Froilán Enciso, a drug policy historian at Mexico's Centro de Investigación y Docencia Económicas University, who said, if you legalize marijuana and or poppy, how can you possibly keep people in prison for crimes related to those plants? I see your point, but you can't say that when it's still illegal. That's like saying, I didn't cheat on you because I had every intent on breaking up with you in the future. So with these three pillars in the fighting the war on drugs, our one key ally in this fight has fundamentally shifted their position. I'll report on how the United States responds on this when we eventually realize that it happened. Until then, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. Remember to give me a thumbs up, and as always, thank you for watching.